Well, if you have your Bibles with you this morning, I encourage you to go ahead and get them out and turn to Genesis chapter 12. We're going to be in Genesis chapter 12 this morning, starting in verse 7 and through chapter 13, verse 4. But before we read our text this morning, I just want to give us a really brief, really quick highlight of where we've been. I think sometimes I spend a lot of time. This morning, I just want to spend a little bit of time just recapping where we've been from Genesis chapter 1 to where we are now. And as we've been unpacking Genesis, there's just really one main point that I want us to hold on to from the very beginning of our study in Genesis, is that there are three main things that kind of stood out in God's call to his people. That is, that they should abide in him, that they should love one another, and that they should testify to the world, and that as a part of that call, that they are distinctly different than the beasts of creation, that they are made in the image and likeness of God, and therefore they are to reflect God in creation. But obviously, the fall kind of messed a lot of those things up, leading eventually to a moment where God was regretful that he had made all things, and there was nothing but wickedness in the heart of man, and so he set to destroy creation. But Noah, as we heard another creation story in and of itself, a recreation story, if you will, Noah's story reflects much of what we saw in Genesis chapters 1, 2, and 3. One of the main things being this idea that Noah is rest. How well have we been resting in God? Do we find ourselves resting in God even as we work through these texts? And then we talked about the Tower of Babel and the pride of humanity wanting to make a name for themselves, so much so that they gathered together to accomplish anything that they wanted. And we said that progress wasn't the problem. It was their desire to make a name for themselves, a name greater than Yahweh. And the very thing that they were worried about was the very consequence of their action. God scatters them throughout the world and confuses their language. Why? Because ultimately, God's desire was that they would come back to him, that they would know him, that they would be in relationship with him, and that would be impossible as they became more and more puffed up within themselves. And so it was actually a grace of God for them to be scattered throughout the world. And along the way, we've been talking about how they keep getting further and further east. The people keep moving eastward until we come to Abram. The family of Abram. And for the first time, there's not a family moving east, but God calls them and they move west. In the east and west language, we said, was east was moving further and further away from Yahweh, and to move west was to move back into his presence, to move back into relationship with him. And specifically, last week, we talked about Abram and how God came to choose this man. Of all the people he could have chosen, what set Abram apart? Other than the fact that God is good and he chooses who he wants at his will, we look at Abram's life and we talked about how Abram was this man of great humility, of great sacrifice, willing to give up for his own gain by taking the barren niece to marry. And throughout this past week, I got a lot of questions. Wait a second. How did Abram know that Sarai was barren? How does he know that? Like, didn't he just find it out later? And so, one, I'll just say the text kind of makes us assume that everybody was already just aware of this. Like, it just seems that that was already just knowledge given. But the way that we can even push this to say, how did they actually know? How is it that it was a given? Well, I want you to consider this, that in that culture, a woman would have been given away in marriage the moment that she was able to menstruate. And so the fact is, at this moment, we know that Sarai is many advanced in years. By the time that they're leaving Haran, she's probably like 65. And so she's been unmarried all of this time, which means that she probably never began to menstruate, which would have immediately made her not eligible to ever be wed. And therefore, it would have been known that she was barren. And so, just to bring that clarification, because I know some people had questions. But that is the beauty of this text. That is the wondrous good news. Especially as we point to Jesus and the people he chooses to use. He can use anybody. He can use any of us. He can use the barren to bless all of creation. He can use you and he can use me in our brokenness to bless our neighbors. And as we hear this story of Abram and how he was this great and wonderful, humble man, I don't want us to think that he was perfect, because he wasn't. Because he was still human like you and I. He still held on to societal ingrained beliefs. He still maybe didn't have full trust and faith in Yahweh's promise that he would become a great nation. There was struggle there. And so let us read our text this morning. Starting in verse 7 of chapter 12. Then Yahweh appeared to Abram and said, "To your seed I will give this land." So he built an altar there to Yahweh who had appeared to him. Then he proceeded from there to the mountain on the east of Bethel, and he pitched his tent with Bethel on the west and Ai on the east, and there he built an altar to Yahweh and called upon the name of Yahweh. And Abram journeyed on, continuing toward the Negev. Now there was a famine in the land, and so Abram went down to Egypt to sojourn there, for the famine was severe in the land. And it happened as he drew near to entering Egypt that he said to Sarai, his wife, "Now behold, I know that you are a woman beautiful in appearance. And it will be when the Egyptians see you, they will say, 'This is his wife,' and they will kill me, but they will let you live. Please say that you are my sister, so that it may go well with me because of you, and that I may live on account of you. Now it happened when Abram came into Egypt that the Egyptians saw that the woman was very beautiful. And Pharaoh's officials saw her and praised her to Pharaoh, and the woman was taken into Pharaoh's house. Therefore he treated Abram well because of her, and sheep and oxen and donkeys and male and female servants and female donkeys and camels came into his possession. But Yahweh struck Pharaoh and his house with great plagues because of Sarai, Abram's wife. Then Pharaoh called upon Abram and said, What is this you have done to me? Why did you not tell me that she was your wife? Why did you say she is my sister, so that I took her for myself as a wife? So now, here is your wife. Take her and go. So Pharaoh commanded his men concerning him, and they sent him away with his wife and all that belonged to him. So Abram went up from Egypt to the Negev, he and his wife and all that belonged to him, and Lot with him. Now Abram was very rich in livestock, in silver and in gold. And he went on his journeys from the Negev as far as Bethel to the place where his tent had been at the beginning, between Bethel and Ai, to the place of the altar, which he had made there formerly, and where Abram called upon the name of Yahweh. Let's pray. Good and gracious God, as we hear these words this morning, I pray that our hearts would be open to receive what it is that you want to teach us. Lord, what it is that we are supposed to glean from this passage, how you have invited us into the text, but also have comprehension of understanding of what it meant for those that heard it for the first time, as the Israelites wandered around in the wilderness. Lord, we love you. We thank you for all your graciousness. It's in your name we pray. Amen. 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 Well, this is an interesting text. And clearly, I think that it demonstrates that Abram was not a perfect man and still had a lot of his old Chaldean beliefs ingrained in who he was. As we read this text, some of us should and probably will take offense to the fact that for him, Sarai was nothing more than an opportunity. His wife was opportunal gain as they went down into Egypt. For him, on her behalf, for him to gain great possession, to gain great wealth, that his life might be spared because his life was more important than her own. I hope that as you heard some of this text, you were like, what in the world is going on? I mean, can we just imagine for a second, for any of you husbands, if you just said to your wife, well, look, we're going to call you my sister, and we're just going to kind of pawn you off so that I could get a great amount of wealth because of it, and that my life would be spared. Like, I'm thinking for a moment about Gary and Sylvia, and just like what Sylvia would do to Gary in that moment. Right? Like, can we just imagine for a second how unacceptable that would be? Here's the thing. I do want to clarify that Abram wasn't necessarily lying when he said, just tell everybody you are my sister. Because it was common practice among those that were in Haran to actually not just marry their wives, but also to adopt them as a sister, as family. And so it wasn't like a complete lie, but it was definitely deceitful. It's definitely wrong. And the reason they did that in Haran was to really secure authority, right, and possession. And again, this is just tied back into all of this old way of thinking where Yahweh has a better plan. Yahweh has a different story that he wants to unfold within his people that looks completely different than every culture and society that surrounds them. I wasn't planning on saying this, but I'm going to go ahead and bring it up because I think it's actually really pivotal as we think about societal change that happened because of Yahweh, that happened because of Jesus. There's a really well-renowned atheist. His name is Richard Dawkins, and he's the author of a book called The God Delusion, and he is what many would call a militant atheist, like absolutely hates anything that is Christian, hates anything that is religious-focused, and is militant in that he attacks it vehemently with everything that he is, to the point that he's even said that religion and Christianity at its center is detrimental to the entire world. And I share that because I think what's so interesting is within the last month, Richard Dawkins is on record in a newscast interview as saying, I am a cultural Christian. And what he means by that is to say that I affirm and believe that the society and culture that Christianity creates is the best society in which humanity can live and flourish. Interesting. Coming out of a man that once was saying that Christianity at its core was the most dangerous thing to the world, and yet now he has changed his tune a little bit, that I want to live in a culture that is Christian because it offers the best way of life. It offers the best moral compass. It offers everything that I would want to live in a society. No other religion can do that, not even atheism. I want everything that God offers in his blessing, but I don't want God. Yahweh has always intentioned that his people would live differently and that the societies he create would be completely different than every other society. And as we read this text, I think we're seeing a glimpse of that society that God wants to create. One of equality. Equality is not a term that existed before Christianity. Women were not equal in any way, shape, or form. They were property. But even in the Old Testament, God's trying to flip this on its head. Sarai was not just a piece of property at which Abram could do whatever he wanted with. It was through Sarai that the promised blessing would come. There was no other plan B for Yahweh. It was always through Abram and Sarai. But I said at the beginning that maybe Abram didn't fully believe this. I think part of evidence of that is if we go back in the text just a little bit, it says that in verse 4 of chapter 12, and so Abram went forth as Yahweh had spoken to him. So he believed Yahweh that he should go. But what's interesting is, and Lot went with him. Well, why would he take his nephew with him in this journey? God called forth Abram and Sarai to go, not Lot. And I think some people have argued, well, because he's the eldest, it's his responsibility to take care of his nephew. I mean, he already married his niece. It makes sense that the nephew should come along, right? But it really doesn't make sense because Nahor still lived in Haran, and he was very wealthy already, and he had a wife who could bear children, and so it really actually made sense for Lot to stay with Nahor in Haran and not to go with Abram to wherever Yahweh was calling him, because he didn't actually know. God just said, I want you to go forth from Haran, and I will give you a nation. But he didn't specify where or when or how long it would take. And so what was the reason for Lot to come? Well, scholars believe, and the rabbinic teaching says, it's because Abram didn't believe that Sarai was ever going to bear the child that would bring the nations. His hope was in Lot. Still his kin and able to bear, but in his household. Lot was coming into his household, and so it made sense. Like, it was still going to come from Abram's household that the nations would be blessed. But Abram didn't hold on to the fact that God said, no, from you, I would bless the world. You know how we kind of can confer that is because if you look a little bit further in Scripture, when Abram is again questioning, how in the world am I going to have a child with Sarai? It just doesn't seem possible. He has Haggai, right? And hopes to bear through Ishmael. And God says, no, that's not it still. And so he's like, okay, so that means that my entire family is then left to Eleazar? He still doesn't get it. God's like, no, the blessing is through you and Sarai, through you and Sarah. I'm going to bless all the world through your children, through Isaac. But Abram doesn't believe that yet. He's not convinced. Even as God calls him forth, even as he goes even with a little bit of doubt. And so, if it's ever been any encouragement, let this be encouragement to you that yes, Abraham's faith was counted to him as righteousness, but his faith was not 100%. We all struggle with doubt sometimes, even Abram. How do we even know this as we continue in the text? Well, we go forth, and in verse 10, and now there was a famine in the land, and so Abram went down to Egypt to sojourn there, for the famine was severe in the land. As we read this text, where does Abram consult Yahweh on the famine? Or does Abram make this decision on his own? I find it really interesting, too, as we read this passage, it kind of reflects the story of the garden a little bit. Food always seems to be at the center of a really poor, sinful decision, and God trying to teach a really big lesson. And remember, too, that this is being told for the first time to the Israelites as they walked in the wilderness. And so their ears are perked up now because they hear Egypt. Egypt? Egypt. Like, if you're coming out of 430 years of slavery, you might have some questions. God, why? Why were we in Egypt for so long? What's going on? How is this possible? What are you trying to do? What are you trying to accomplish? And so I think it's a little bit of comfort to the Israelites as they continue to wander the wilderness is, hey, look, Egypt's always been a problem. You know, you ended up in Egypt that next time also because of a famine, right? It was a famine in the promised land that made Jacob and all of his 12 sons, 11 sons, go to Egypt in the first place, where they ran into Joseph, the other son that they sold into slavery. And what's amazing to me is even in Genesis chapter 15, verses 13 through 16, God even already lets Abraham know there's going to come a time and your people are going to be enslaved for 400 years. God's got this whole story all worked out. It's always been a part of God's plan. But why? Why is this such a part of what God is trying to do? Well, we already talked about how Abram was kind of this counter to the people of Babel, where the people in Babel wanted to gather together, and yet they were scattered. Or they were people of pride, sorry. And Abram was a person of sacrifice, of humility. But this morning I was talking to one of our missionary partners and from Ben Doubt, who's in Cambodia. And actually it's not this morning, but over the last couple of days we've been sending messages back and forth because our timetables are very different. So it's day here and it's night there and it's, yeah, anyways. So we're kind of talking about it because he reached out and he's like, hey, I was listening to one of your last sermons and I really love how you compared, you know, Babel and Abram together. And he's like, and he shared this with me. He said one of his Bible professors once shared that it's really interesting that in Babel, and this is what I was saying and I got ahead of myself, in Babel, their desire was to gather together and God scattered them because of their pride. And for Abram, what's interesting is that God scatters him from his homeland so that Yahweh might gather a people together. And it requires a certain level of humility. And all along, as we read these stories in Genesis, as we read these stories for the people that are wandering the wilderness, as we read this story about them going down into Egypt, I find it also interesting that this is a chiasm. We've been talking about chiasms, right, where there's always something pointed to the center, but you can see it from the outsides. This chiasm's marked by verse 7. Yahweh appears to Abram and says, to your seed I will give this land. And so what does Abram do? He builds an altar to Yahweh, and then he goes from there to Bethel and builds another altar. And then he journeys on, continuing toward the Negev. And then there's a famine, so he goes down to Egypt. And then he instructs his wife and how she should carry herself in Egypt. And then Sarai is taken, and Yahweh punishes Egypt. And then we start coming back out of the chiasm, where Pharaoh then instructs Abram of why did he do this. And then he's expelled out of Egypt. He's told to go from Egypt. And as he goes from Egypt, he goes back to the Negev. And from the Negev, he goes back to Bethel, to the altar. And from the altar, he calls once again upon the name of Yahweh. And so we've built in and out of this story. And what I find so interesting is that in Babel, they're trying to create a structure that reaches to heaven so that they may be equal to God. People really love building things. And Abram builds a structure multiple times, not to reach heaven, not to be greater than God, but to acknowledge him and worship him. He builds altars along the way. And this is so significant because if we turn to 2 Samuel chapter 7, 1 through 7, it says this: Now it happened when the king inhabited his house, speaking of King David, and Yahweh had given him rest on every side from all of his enemies, that the king said to Nathan the prophet, "See now, I inhabit a house of cedar, but the ark of God inhabits tent curtains." So Nathan said to the king, "Go, do all that is in your heart, for Yahweh is with you." And now it happened in the same night that the word of Yahweh came to Nathan, saying, "Go and say to my servant David, thus says Yahweh, are you the one who would build me a house to inhabit? For I have not inhabited a house since the day I brought up the sons of Israel from Egypt, even to this day, but I have been going about in a tent, even in a tabernacle. Wherever I have gone about with all the sons of Israel, did I speak a word with one of the tribes of Israel, which I commanded to shepherd my people in Israel, saying, why have you not built me a house of cedar?" Yahweh is a God on the move. He is not a God who wants to stay in one place. He's not a God to remain in one place. And even when Solomon built the temple, his final prayer was, but what can this house, how can this house keep Yahweh in? Acknowledging that God was not a God of one place, but a God of all places, which went against every cultural belief at that time, because they had many gods. And the many gods had their own territories, and they remained in their own places, and there wasn't a God that went out to all the other places. There wasn't a God for everyone. Everyone had their own gods. And what's so significant in Egypt is this is the first time we see a people going to another land and Yahweh having power over the people. And we see it again in the Exodus that this is not just a God who stays in Canaan. This isn't just a God of the ancient Near East. He's a God of the world. And he's a God above every other God. And he's a God who wants to go out to all the people of the world. I think that's why it's so significant that when Jesus was talking about his ministry and where he was going and how he was calling people, he said to them, "Foxes have holes, and the birds of the air have their nests, but the Son of Man has nowhere to lay his head." He's wondering. And so what a comfort to the people in Israel as they wandered in the wilderness that they were always meant to be a wandering people. A people that went out, and that as much as they are being called to the promised land, to a place that they might call their home, they're not supposed to just stay there. They're not meant to be in one place. I can't help but going back to Ashley's sermon a couple months ago, and going back to Matthew 28:19, what was the call? Go, therefore, to all the nations. As you are going, baptize people in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, commanding them to obey all that I have taught you. We might be a people that find settlement in one place, but we are not supposed to settle. And Abram is a man, just like you and me, not perfect, but the one God called, humble, one willing to go, one willing to be scattered in order to fulfill what God wants to do in the world. And though he doesn't have perfect understanding of how God's going to accomplish it, he goes forth. And he makes some mistakes along the way. He ends up in Egypt. He ends up being deceitful, ends up selling out his wife. But as he's expelled, I think this is the important thing. Because I said this had relationship to the garden. A lot of the same questions that Pharaoh says, we find in Genesis chapter 3 and chapter 4. Who told you? What is this that you have done to me? Why did you not tell me that she was your wife? What did the snake actually say? What did you say? She is my sister. So I took her for myself as a wife. So here is your wife. Take her and go. And God said to Adam and Eve, go east of the garden. Get out. Go. But what's interesting is in the progression of the story of Adam and Eve and their children is they move east away from Yahweh. But Abram returns to an altar of God. And it reminds us, and to the place of the altar which he had made there formerly, and there Abram called upon the name of Yahweh. The reminder for us today, no matter where you find yourself ending up in life, circumstances, life's sufferings, life's doubts, moments of faithlessness, whatever might be going through your heart, whatever struggle you're going through, whatever sin decision you recently made, however you ended up in your own Egypt, God wants you to return to him. He's always wanting his people to return to him. He's always wanted his people to return to him. And even as the Israelites wander in the desert, wondering what the purpose of it all is, Yahweh's purpose is for them to return to him. How are we, in our weakest moments, just like Abram, returning to Yahweh? How are we returning to Jesus? How are we coming back to him in his goodness and his faithfulness to us as he continues to be faithful? Let's pray. Good and gracious God, we love that you call your children unto yourself. We love that mistake after mistake gets made. We still sin. Even after receiving wonderful blessings and wonderful words of your provision, just like Abram, we can still have our doubt as to how you're actually going to accomplish it. And yet you are still faithful to us. You still love us and you still want us to come back to you. It just reminds me of how in the letter to the Hebrews, we have a God who is not unable to sympathize with us. And we have a God who is calling us to come to him in our moment of need before the throne of mercy and grace. We are imperfect. Teach us, Lord, what it looks like to reflect your image to a world. Show us and call us back to you as we call upon your name. We know that our cries do not fall on deaf ears. We love you, Lord. We thank you. It's in the name of Jesus we pray. Amen.